In this video, we're going to prove two very important results about conversions in measure spaces. Before we start, let me remind you that if you want to support the channel, you can do so in three different ways. You can donate on Ko-fi, become a member on Patreon, or buy items in our store. All the links for that are in the description of the video. We're going to prove that if we have a sequence that's Cauchy in measure, then there is some function f for which the sequence converges to in measure. So the proof for this part is going to require us to build the function f. And so you can imagine that it's going to be quite difficult. And then we prove that there is some subsequence that converges almost everywhere to this function f. The challenge in this proof is to build this function f only from knowing that our sequence is Cauchy in measure. And then we have this corollary that says that if a sequence converges in L1 to some function f, then there is some subsequence for which the subsequence converges pointwise almost everywhere. So let's first prove this corollary because it follows quite trivially from the theorem. We have a sequence fn that converges to f in L1. So from what we saw in our previous video, we know that L1 convergence implies convergence in measure. So in particular, this sequence fn will converge to f in measure. And so whenever we have something that converges in measure, in particular, that means that that sequence will be Cauchy in measure. And so we are now under the hypothesis of this theorem. We have fn is going to be a sequence that's Cauchy in measure. And well, in this case, we don't have to build this function f because it's already given. Of course, the limit is unique, and so this f is going to be the same as this one. But then applying the theorem, we know that there will exist some subsequence fnj such that fnj converges to the function f almost everywhere. And so that's exactly what we wanted for the corollary. So then L1 converges does not exactly imply pointwise convergence or even pointwise almost everywhere, but it does imply that there exists a subsequence where we have almost every convergence. Now let's prove the main theorem. Like I said, the main challenge is going to be finding this function f for which we have convergence in measure. So we have fn that's Cauchy in measure. Remember that what this meant is that from the point of view of our measure, the sequence of functions is Cauchy. That means the measure of all the points where our sequence is not Cauchy, so where fn of x minus fm of x is not Cauchy, so it's greater than or epsilon for some positive epsilon. For our measure, this set is very small. It will go to zero when n and m go to infinity. So this is just the definition of Cauchy in measure. And we want to build a function f so that we have convergence in measure. So we want to somehow replace this fm by some function f. And what we will do for that is using the standard method of passing through a subsequence. So ideally, I want to start quantifying these things in a way that I can count them. So because epsilon is too big, I want to quantify it differently, and I will do that by using just natural numbers. And I will have to somehow link this epsilon with some subsequence here. So what I'm thinking about doing now is, well, maybe not consider the set like this, but consider, for example, fnj of x, fn, and I want to take into account the following element in the sequence of x, and I want to say that this number here is greater than some quantifiable number, and the easiest way to do that, and maybe our initial assumption, would be to say, well, I'm having here j is moving, so why not put 1 over j? And then What I want is the set to have small measure. So maybe I can say something like the measure of this set less than 1 over j. So what we're trying to do is build for any x, or for most x, a Cauchy sequence of real numbers, and then just take that limit, and that will be the definition that I will use for my function. I have to always go back to the basics, and in this case the basics is, well, the real numbers are complete. So if I have a Cauchy sequence of real numbers, I have a limit, and I can define my function. This is an initial assumption, so let's start with this and see if we can maybe modify. We'll see that it won't work exactly, but it will give us some idea of what to do. So what I want to do next is count how much error I have. And, well, this is the set that is kind of measuring my error. Let's call it E sub j. So E sub j's are measuring the error, and so I can define these sets fn to be the error from some point onwards. And what I want to do is show that this accumulating error is very small. Being small here and always in this reproduction list means that it has small measure. So let's calculate the measure of these sets. So this is just the measure of a union. And so by subadditivity, because I don't know if these sets are disjoint or not, this is gonna be the sum of the measures. And we just said that this set had measure 1 over j. And now here is where I see that I did something wrong, because this is gonna be diverged, and I want the measure of fn to be small. So how can I choose this subsequence differently so that this sum actually converges? And pretty much the only sum we know converges is 2 to the minus j. So, well, don't take 1 over j. Take instead 2 to the minus j. And then here, we won't have this. We'll have 2 to the minus j. And now, well, this sum is a bit weird because it's starting on n. So if I subtract n everywhere, I get the sum from j equals 0 up to infinity, 2 to the minus j minus n, and this will converge 2 to the 1 minus n. So this measure is small, and it's getting smaller as n increases. That's perfect. That's exactly what we wanted. So now, going back to this, what I'm doing is just choose some subsequence f and j such that this happens. And we know we can do this because our sequence is Cauchy in measure. So I take a Cauchy in measure sequence, I choose a subsequence that will give me small errors. And what I want to prove now is that this subsequence is actually Cauchy pointwise. So for any x, I want to show that f and j of x is Cauchy. Well, I'm not going to be able to do that for every x, but let's think about what happens if I take x that's not in this set fn. Remember, fn is just accumulating all the error. So hopefully my sequence or my subsequence will be Cauchy for points that are not in this set that accumulates error. To show that my subsequence is Cauchy here, I'm going to take f n j of x and f n, and let's say l of x, and I want to show that this is small. So x is a fixed number, and now I want to take j and l big enough, so they're going to be at least as big as n. So what does it mean for x to not be in fn? Remember, fn is the union of all the ej's from n onwards. So if x is not here, that means that x is not in ej for j's greater than or equal to n. And that's a good thing, because for these elements here we have not Cauchy. So I'm actually just grabbing all those x for which I do have Cauchy. And so This will probably satisfy a Cauchy condition, and we can work it out. So I know the behavior of my subsequence in consecutive elements, because this is what I did here. So I can just use triangular inequality many times, and that will give me the sum from, and let's add a new index, I equals j up to l minus 1 of fn j plus 1 minus fn j. And now these are the ones that I know how to compare, because of these are the ones that don't satisfy this condition, so I'm going to have less than or equal to there. And so, in total, when I add everything together, this is going to give me 2 to the 1 minus L, using a similar argument to the one we had here. So that's fine, that makes sense. If I take a point in the set where my sequence did seem to be Cauchy, then I have kind of like a point-wise Cauchy condition. So what we show here is that the sequence f and j of x is Cauchy. But this is Cauchy of real numbers, because we are evaluating our functions. And this doesn't happen ever. It happens here. So only if x is not in this family of sets. But this doesn't concern us, because we know that fn are sets with small measure. So now we want to kind of paste everything together and take limits everywhere. So I want to somehow graph absolutely every error I have and define my sequence as the limit of this Cauchy sequence. So what we can do for that is to take all the errors together. We're going to define the set F to be just the intersection of all these sets Fn. Now remember, Fn were the union of the sets Ej, so this is going to be the intersection of the union from j equals n to infinity of Ej. And now this is just the definition of a Lim-sup. So I'm taking the Lim-sup of all my errors, and my objective will be to show that the measure of this set F is small, because I want to see that the accumulated error is always small. I have a Lim-sup of sets, and so if we go back to the first properties that we showed for measures, we know that we have to show two things: that this sequence of sets is decreasing, and that at least one of the elements in my sequence of sets has finite measure. So let's see that fn is decreasing. Now, fn is the union of all the ej's from j equals 1 up to infinity. So it's en union all the rest, and all the rest are the fn plus 1. So fn is adding something to fn plus 1. So that implies that fn plus 1 is a subset of fn. And so this shows that my sequence is indeed decreasing, and of course it will decrease to the Lim-sup. But also, we know that the measure of f1, we can just say this is going to be a small number, because it's 2 to the minus something, in particular is smaller than 1, so it's finite. And now, using the properties of measures, we know that the measure of f is going to be the limit of the measures of fn. And these were 2 to the minus n, and so this limit is 0. So what we have is that for points x that are not in f, my sequence is Cauchy. But f is a set of measures 0. So I can define my function to be whatever I want in f, and then in the points not in f, just to be the limit of the Cauchy sequence. And that's exactly what we do. I know that for any x that's not in f, the limit of this subsequence exists, because this was just a Cauchy sequence of real numbers. So I want to define f to be this limit, whatever it exists, and well, if x is in f, just define it to be 0. I don't care, because f is a set of measure 0. So our measure will only care about these points. So going back to what we wanted to prove, we took a sequence that was Cauchy in measure, and we built a function. Well, hopefully we did things correctly so that we have both these conversions. Now, the convergence pointwise, almost everywhere, is clear because of what we just did. But we still have to prove that the original sequence converges in measure to this function f that we just defined. So let's go ahead and do that. It shouldn't be difficult because we took everything very carefully. So now we're going to show that fn converges in measure to f. For that, we take epsilon and we study the measure of the set of points x such that fn of x minus f of x is greater than epsilon. We want to see that this set has measure 0. And what we will do is, well, we add and subtract the subsequence. So let me just add fnj of x minus fnj of x, because this is the only thing that I actually know. And we will split it, get fn with minus the sequence, and then these two together. And we will have the measure of some sum greater than epsilon. And we now use the typical trick in measure theory and in probability theory that this is going to be less than or equal to the measure of the union of two sets. The set where fn of x minus fnj of x is greater than epsilon over 2. Union the numbers where f and j of x minus f of x is greater than epsilon over 2. And now we can just split this union into two measures, but this trivially just goes to 0 when n and j go to infinity. So that proves that the sequence fn converges in measure to f.